Welcome to the distinguished lecture series of the Indian Mathematics Consortium. The aim here is to host virtual colloquia by some of the best researchers and expositors around the world. The speakers are carefully chosen by the scientific committee from among mathematicians who are not only distinguished researchers, but are also known for the quality of their exposition. The principal aim here is to make the talks as widely accessible as possible, especially to PhD students. With this in view, the format of most of the talks will be in two stages. First, there will be a pre-recorded talk by the speaker, which will be posted online. Interested audience can then view this at their leisure and communicate questions, if any, to the organizers. The second stage will be a live interactive session between the speaker and interested participants, and that will be held about 2 weeks after posting the online talk. The approximate duration of the talk will be about 45 minutes, and that of the interactive session will be about half an hour. The Distinguished Lecture Series is co-hosted by IIT Bombay and ICTS Bangalore. Welcome.
It is a great honor to introduce Nalini Anantharaman. Nalini Anantharaman is professor at the University of Strasbourg. After being professor in Orsay and being visiting scholar in Princeton and Berkeley, her exceptional mathematical achievements have received many awards, notably the Salem Prize, the Nemers Prize, and in India, the Infosys Prize. She was a plenary speaker in the ICM in Rio in 2018 and was elected to the French Academy of Science. She works at the interaction between geometry and analysis and has made amazing progresses in the study of quantum chaos. So let us say a few words about quantum chaos. Classical mechanics studies particles which are following trajectories described by an ordinary differential equation. For quantum mechanics, particles are functions, wave function, following Schrödinger equation and seen through the probability or density they define on the space. There is a way to go from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, but this procedure is only well defined in the context of what are called completely integrable systems. So these are systems for which there are many conserved quantities and the dynamics is well behaved in some way. At the opposite of these systems are chaotic systems, and the most prominent one is a geodesic flow on hyperbolic surfaces. In that context, classical elementary particles are closed geodesics, while the analogues of quantum elementary particles are wave functions, are eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. As a classical consequence of chaos, closed geodesics become equidistributed. The prediction of the unique quantum ergodicity conjecture by Rudnick and Sarnak in 1991 is that the eigenfunctions also become equidistributed. The family of probability measure they define converge. Thanks to Nalini Anantharaman's work, amazing progresses have been made in the study of this conjecture. Let's now hear her talk.
Hello everybody, thank you very much for this invitation to give a talk at this colloquium, and thanks a lot to François Laborie for giving me advice on how to record this talk. Today I would like to talk about uncertainty principles and uncertainty inequalities. As we will see, and as you may already know, an uncertainty principle is any statement saying that if we have a restriction on the size of the support of a function f, or on its decay at infinity, then we have a restriction going in the opposite direction, saying that its Fourier transform cannot have a too small support or cannot decay too fast. This subject has been studied a lot, in particular in India. I must say that to prepare this talk, I read with great pleasure the survey paper by Folland and Sitaram, for which I will give the reference at the end of the talk. It's really a very old and very lively subject, and of course it would be impossible to say to quote all the existing results. I will only give a few statements. I will start with a few easy but useful facts. Then I will state some classics, the Heisenberg principle, its entropic form, and the Hardy and Berlin uncertainty principles. Then at the end, I will give some more contemporary statements, and hopefully I will have time also to say how this is related to my research. Some notation, if I have a function defined on the real line, its Fourier transform f hat is also a function on the real line. F hat of psi is, I take the notation that f hat of psi is the integral of f of x exponential minus 2 pi I psi x dx. With this convention, f and f hat have the same L2 norm. So the Fourier transform is an isometry on L2. If f is periodic, is one periodic, then one speaks of Fourier coefficients that are defined similarly, but now the integral is only taken over a period, and n is an integer. And I will also speak sometimes of the discrete Fourier transform. So now f is defined on a discrete circle, a discrete torus, so f is defined on z mod nz, and its Fourier transform f hat is also defined on n z mod nz by the formula f hat of w is 1 over square root of n, sum from x going from 0 to n minus 1 of f of x exponential minus 2 pi I w x for, oh, there is a typo, it's not psi here, but for w in z mod nz. And with this convention, the discrete Fourier transform is also of norm 1 in L2. Of course, all these notions also have versions in higher dimension. For instance, if f is defined on Rd, then its Fourier transform is also defined on Rd. The first easy but very useful fact that one has to note is that if f has compact support, then f hat cannot have compact support unless f is equal to 0. And this is simply because of the definition of f hat. One sees that f hat can be extended to a holomorphic function on C. And a holomorphic function has isolated zeros unless it vanishes, so it cannot have compact support on the real line. Actually, here, the assumption was too strong. The only thing I need is that f hat should have a holomorphic extension on a strip containing the real axis. So it's enough to assume that f decays exponentially fast at infinity to have this statement. So now, let's assume that both f and f hat have L2 norm equal to 1. One can show very easily that if f vanishes outside a set U and f hat vanishes outside a set V, we must have that the measure of U times the measure of V must be at least 1. And to show this, one says that the L2 norm of f hat restricted to V is at most the size of V times the L infinity norm of f hat square, but the L infinity norm of f hat is at most the L1 norm of f. And by Cauchy-Schwarz, the L1 norm of f is at most the size of the support of f times the L2 norm of f. So this is how we prove this statement, but later on we will see a more refined statement due to Benedict saying that if f vanishes outside the set U, which is a finite measure, and if f hat vanishes outside the set V, which is a finite measure, we must actually have that f is equal to 0. A slight variation of the same argument says that if f is small in L1 norm outside U. So if the L1 norm of F on the complement of U is at most epsilon 1, and if the L2 norm of F hat on the complement of V is at most epsilon 2, we must have that the size of U times the size of V is at least 1 minus epsilon 2 square, 1 minus epsilon 1 square. Here, F and F hat didn't play symmetric roles because I used the L1 norm for F and the L2 norm for F hat. If one wants to use the L2 norm for both F and F hat, one has the following statement that I found in a paper, a very nice paper by Donohoe and Stark, for which I will also give the reference at the end of the talk. So if the L2 norm of F outside U is less than epsilon 1 and the L2 norm of F hat outside V is less than epsilon 2, we must have that the size of U times the size of V is at least 1 minus epsilon 1 minus epsilon 2 square. There is a similar statement with the same proof for the discrete Fourier transform. Now the size of U and V should be measured by the cardinality, of course. And I will prove on the blackboard that if F vanishes outside a set U, then F hat cannot have more than cardinality of U consecutive zero. So if F vanishes outside the set U of cardinality capital M, then it's not possible for F hat to have capital M consecutive zeros. And this implies that the cardinality of the support of F hat is at least N divided by capital M. And in particular, if M doesn't divide N, then the inequality must be strict.
Okay, so let's start with the proof. Let's consider a function f defined on z mod nz, so from z mod nz to C, and let's assume that f vanishes outside the set of cardinality capital M. Let's call x1, x2, xm, the points where f doesn't vanish, and what we want to show is that the discrete Fourier transform of f cannot vanish on m consecutive points. Let me rewrite the definition of the discrete Fourier transform. F hat of W is 1 over square root n times the sum of f of x exponential minus 2 I pi over n w x. So normally the sum runs for x from, so x here is from 0 to n minus 1, but actually we can have only sum over the x I, so we are summing just over the point x I here, and I is now from m, from 1 to capital M. So let's assume that f hat vanishes on m consecutive points. That is to say, it vanishes on k plus 1, k plus m minus 1, for some k. That means that f hat of k plus j is equal to 0 for j between 0 and n minus 1. And for this, I rewrite once again the expression of the discrete Fourier transform. So this is again the sum of from 1 to m, f of xi exponential minus 2 I pi over n. So now w is k plus j. Xn. And this has to be zero for j running from zero to m minus one. Okay, maybe let me erase the top of the blackboard. Let's do like this. So this equation I'm going to rewrite as, so I'm just rearranging the sum slightly. So it's the sum from I equal running from 1 to, from 1 to n of f of xi exponential minus 2i pi over n. Here I have k times xi. And the other term I write as exponential minus 2i pi over n xi to the power j. So this number I call, this coefficient I call bi, and this complex number here I call zi. So I have that the sum of bi zi to the j is equal to zero for any j between zero and n minus one, which means, so it means that if I multiply, if I multiply the matrix, which is, so I have a Vandermonde matrix here, 1, z1, z1 to the power m minus 1, 1, z2, z2 to the power m minus 1, etc. 1, zm to the power m minus 1, multiplied by the vector of coefficient b1 bn, which is equal to zero. And as you may know, this Vandermonde matrix is invertible as soon as the zi are distinct complex numbers. So this is an invertible matrix, so I must have that all the bi's are zero, whereas I assume that they were non-zero because the xi were the values where f of xi didn't vanish. And this is the end of the proof of the lemma.
Okay, so I continue this talk now with a few classical forms of the uncertainty principle. Probably the most famous one is the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, stated by the physicist Heisenberg in the 20s. He was one of the founders of quantum mechanics. So let's assume that F and F hat have L2 norm equal to 1. So F of X square is a probability density on R, as well as f hat of psi square. In physics, f of x square would measure the probability distribution of the position of the particle, and f hat of psi square would measure the probability distribution for the momentum of the particle. And the Heisenberg principle says that for any a and b in R, the mean distance of x between x and a square times the mean distance between psi and b square cannot be too small. It must be at least 1 over 16 pi squared. So it's not possible for x to be very concentrated around the point A and at the same time for psi to be very concentrated around a point B. And there is equality in the Heisenberg principle only if F is a Gaussian centered at A and F hat is a Gaussian centered at B. We will prove the Heisenberg principle with A and B equal to zero. We can always assume this by translation, translation of F and translation of F hat. And here goes the proof. One starts with some integration by part to show that the integral of f of x squared can be rewritten as minus 2 times the real part of the integral of xf times f prime. This is actually the subtle part of the proof. One has to show that one has to justify that f is differentiable, that f prime is in L2, and of course by assumption xf is also in L2, and one has also to justify the integration by part on the whole line. Then by Cauchy-Schwarz, the L2 norm of f to the power 4, which is also the square of this integral, and it can be bounded by 4 times x square, the integral of x square f square times the integral of f prime square. The first term is the one we want, is the distance from x to 0 square, the mean distance from x to 0. And for this, the second one, one notes that by the Planck-Schreil formula, the L2 norm of f prime is also the L2 norm of the Fourier transform of f prime, but the Fourier transform of f prime is just psi times f hat. And this concludes the proof. To have equality, there is equality if and only if there is equality in the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, and for this we need f prime to be a constant times xf. And if we solve this differential equation, we see that f must be a Gaussian. A variant of this, or in the same spirit, I would like to state, and I will prove on the blackboard, the Hardy uncertainty principle. It says that if a function f decays faster than a Gaussian of a certain variance, like exponential minus pi a x squared, and if the Fourier transform f hat decays faster than exponential minus pi psi squared over a, then f must be a multiple of exponential minus pi a x squared. And now I will go to the blackboard. In a few minutes, I will go to the blackboard to prove this. But first, I would like to state a variant that I like very much, which is due to Burling, and which says that if I have any two functions phi and psi, having the property that phi of x plus psi of psi grow at least like 2 pi psi x, if f multiplied by exponential phi is integrable, and if f hat multiplied by exponential psi is integrable, then we must have f equal to 0. And for instance, we can think of phi and psi to be convex conjugate functions. For instance, we can take phi equal pi a x squared and psi equal pi psi squared over a. Okay, I continue the talk by stating an anthropic form of the uncertainty principle, which is one that I used in my research. Let's start with the fact that the Fourier transform is an isometry from L2 to L2. And we also know that its norm from L1 to L infinity is at most 1. By complex interpolation, we can deduce that for any t between 0 and 1, the norm of the Fourier transform from L to the 2 over 1 plus t to L to the 2 over 1 minus t is at most 1. If we take the derivative of this inequality at t equals 0, and if we use the fact that the derivative of the LP norm of a function is the entropy of the LP norm at p equal 2 is the entropy of this function, then we find the following inequality saying that the entropy of the probability distribution f squared plus the entropy of the probability distribution f hat squared is at least 0. Here, the entropy is defined using the usual function capital H. H of rho is minus rho log rho. And if we have a probability density, its entropy can be any number between minus infinity and plus infinity. If it will tend to be close to minus infinity if the probability density is concentrated near one point. So the fact that the sum of these two entropies is positive is one way of expressing the fact that it's not possible for f and f hat to be both very concentrated at around one point. It turns out that this inequality is not optimal. And this is because the estimate on the norm of the Fourier transform from L1 to L infinity is also not optimal. If we use the optimal bound due to Bechner, we find the sharp version of the entropic uncertainty principle. In dimension D, the entropy of F plus the entropy of F hat must be at least D times 1 minus log of 2. And by the way, I could have mentioned it before, but the proof of the Heisenberg principle that I gave earlier was very specific to dimension 1. If we wanted to prove it in higher dimension, we would need to find a different proof. From the entropic version, we can deduce some form of the Heisenberg principle in dimension D, which says that if we take the covariance matrix of the probability distribution F squared, take the determinant of the covariance matrix, and take also the determinant of the covariance matrix of the probability distribution F hat squared, the product of these two determinants is bounded below by the number 1 over 4 pi to the power 2d. Okay, let's take one slide to think about the various avatars of the uncertainty principle that we have encountered so far. On the left, we have a statement on the support of the Fourier transform F hat or on its decay at infinity. So for instance, we assume that F hat has compact support or that it decays fast enough at infinity or that it has a small support in measure or that it vanishes on some large set. Saying that F satisfies some PDE can also be a way of can also very often be translated into a statement on the support of the Fourier transform. For instance, in my research, I'm very interested in eigenfunctions of the Laplacian, and saying that minus Laplacian F is equal to lambda F is the same as saying that F hat is supported on a sphere of radius square root of lambda. Of course, here I'm going out of the setting of L2 functions. F hat is going to be a distribution. Talking on holomorphic function can be also expressed by a PDE. A holomorphic function is a function satisfying d bar f equal to 0. And on the right, we have statements on f itself saying that f cannot vanish on a large set, for instance, on an open set or on a set of positive measure. F cannot decay too fast, must have a large support, or in PDE, one says that a PDE satisfies the unique continuation property if solutions of this PDE cannot vanish on some open set. Okay, let's continue with some more recent statement of the uncertainty principle. And there is first the very simple statement, and actually the proof that I'm going to do on the blackboard is not very complicated, it's very elegant, and it's due to Benedict, saying that if f vanishes outside the set U of finite measure and f hat vanishes outside the set V of finite measure, then f must be equal to zero. There is a quantitative form of this due to Amrhein and Berthier, saying that the L2 norm of f is bounded by a constant depending on U and V times the sum of the L2 norm of f restricted to the complement of U plus the L2 norm of f hat restricted to the complement of V. So in particular, I find again the previous statement that if f vanishes outside U and f hat vanishes outside V, f must be zero. And in dimension one, Nazarov proved in 1993 that the constant C can be made completely explicit in terms of U and V, and it's exponential times the constant times the Lebesgue measure of U times the Lebesgue measure of V.
Okay, so now I want to give the proof, very elegant proof due to Benedict, of the fact that if I have a function f in L1 of R, which vanishes outside the set U, and such that its Fourier transform vanishes outside the set V, U and V assume to be measurable. And if the Lebesgue measure of U and the Lebesgue measure of V are both finite, then F must be zero. Okay? And by scaling, we can always assume that the Lebesgue measure of U is strictly less than 1. I'm going to introduce a new function capital L, f of t, that I'm going to define as the sum over all integers of f of t plus n. So it's going to be a one periodic function. And actually, I'm going to need an extra parameter. So I'm going to multiply this by exponential minus 2i pi a times t plus n. So f depends on the parameter a. It's still a one periodic function. Okay, and you can show that it's well defined everywhere because the integral from 0 to 1 of the sum over all integers of modulus of t plus n, of f of t plus n dt is just equal to, you can show that it's just equal to the L1 norm of f on the whole real line, which is finite. So this integral is finite, and this implies that capital F is well defined for almost every t. Now let's consider the characteristic function, the indicator function of the set E, of the set U. So U is the set outside which F vanishes. And note that if I consider the sum over all integers of the characteristic function of U applied to t plus n, this function takes values either zero or an integer, or it can also be infinite, but it counts the number of integers such that t plus n belongs to the set U. And it's again, it's a one periodic function, and if I integrate it from 0 to 1, you can check that I find the Lebesgue measure of U, which is by assumption less, strictly less than 1. If I have a function here which is either 0 or an integer, and its integral from 0 to 1 is strictly less than 1, it means that it must vanish on a set of positive measures. So there must exist some measurable subset B of 0, 1 of positive global measure such that the sum over n of indicator function of u t plus n vanishes for t in B. So for t in this set B, the number of integers such that t plus n belongs to u is equal to 0. And remember, f vanishes outside u. So it implies that the function capital F also vanishes. So vanishes on the set B. Okay? This is what I have shown. There is a set B of positive measure of which the function capital F vanishes. Now, so let me erase the top. So now let's compute the Fourier coefficient of the function capital F. As a one periodic function, I can compute the Fourier coefficients of capital F. So the Fourier coefficient number n is the integral from 0 to 1 of f capital F of t exponential minus 2 I pi n t dt. So it's also the integral of from 0 to 1 of the sum of integers of f t plus n. Here now I should maybe give the index a different name, so I'm summing over all integers k. The sum over k of f of t plus k exponential minus 2 I pi a t plus k exponential minus 2 I pi n t dt. And by interverting the sum and the integral and doing change of variable, you can show that this is nothing else but the Fourier transform of f evaluated at n plus k. So there is a relation between the Fourier coefficients of capital F and the Fourier transform of small f. Now let's apply the same trick as before. Let's consider the integrator function of the set V. V, remember that capital F vanishes. F hat vanishes outside V. And V is a finite measure. So if I consider the sum over n of the integrator function of V applied to t plus n, this counts the number of integers n such that t plus n, already I should now say a. So this counts the number of integers n such that n plus a belongs to V. If I integrate from a running to 0 to 1, I find the Lebesgue measure of V, which has been assumed to be finite. So if the integral of this function is finite, this implies that the function itself is finite almost everywhere. So the sum over integers of the indicator functions of V evaluated at a plus 1 is finite for almost every e in 0, 1. So for almost every a, the number of integers n such that a plus n belongs to v is finite. In other words, remember that f hat vanishes outside v. So I can say that the number of n such that f hat of n plus a is not zero is finite for almost every a. So I conclude that for almost every a, the number of integers n such that the Fourier coefficient number n of f sub a is not zero is finite. And a function, a one-periodic function that has only a finite number of non-zero Fourier coefficients is nothing else but a trigonometric polynomial. So for almost every a, f a is a trigonometric polynomial. And remember that FA vanishes on B, on the set B, which is a set of positive measures, so B must be infinite. But the trigonometric polynomial cannot vanish on an infinite set unless it is zero. So FA vanishes, we have seen that FA vanishes on B, which is infinite. So FA is identically zero for almost every A, and this implies that F hat is zero and that F is zero. So F hat and F are both equal to zero, and this finishes the proof.
Okay. So far I've given a survey talk about the uncertainty principle. Now I would like to take 10 more minutes to say how it relates to my own research and how I came to be interested in uncertainty principles in my own research. This is in relation to the quantum ergodicity conjecture. So let's M be a compact Riemannian manifold, and we'll be interested in the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. The Laplacian has eigenvalues lambda k, because the manifold is compact, it has discrete spectrum, and the spectrum, the eigenvalues, are a sequence of numbers going to infinity. And we'll be interested in the eigenfunctions, psi k, always normalized in L2. And the main objects we will be interested in are the probability measures on M, having density with respect to the Riemannian volume, psi of x squared. In physics, this would be, let's say, the probability density for the position of the particle x. After extracting a subsequence, we can always assume that this sequence of probability measure has a limit nu, which is a probability measure on M. And the question is, depending on the geometry of the manifold, to understand what is nu. The quantum unique ergodicity conjecture, formulated by Sarnak and Rudnick in 1994, says that if M is a negatively curved manifold, then necessarily the limiting measure nu must be the volume measure, the uniform measure, which would express a property of delocalization of eigenfunctions in the limit where lambda k goes to infinity. This is very specific to negative curvature. For instance, if we were on a sphere which has positive curvature, then it's well known that there are spherical harmonics that concentrate to an equator in the limit of large eigenvalue. So their limit is actually a singular measure carried on a closed geodesic. The quantum unique ergodicity conjecture actually has a stronger form, which is phrased on the phase space of classical mechanics, that is to say the cotangent bundle,
The quotient bundle is the set of pairs x and psi, where x is a point on the manifold measuring the position of the particle, and psi is a quotient vector at x measuring the momentum of the particle. In microlocal analysis, the momentum psi is always identified as well with the Fourier variable. And it's a very general fact coming from microlocal analysis that I'm not going to explain today, that the measure nu obtained as a limit of eigenfunctions actually can be lifted to a measure mu on the cotangent bundle. So mu is a measure on phase space, which projects to nu under the projection on the first coordinate. And this measure mu has additional structure just coming from the fact that nu is obtained as a limit of eigenfunctions. Mu is supported on vectors of norm 1, and even more importantly, mu is invariant under a certain dynamical system called the geodesic flow. Mu is invariant if we transport the measure under geodesics, along geodesics. And this is very general. This is on any manifold. I'm not using any assumption on the manifold so far. The quantum unique ergodicity conjecture says that if M has negative curvature, the measure mu on phase space must be the Lebesgue measure, which is also called in this context the Liouville measure. So it's both uniform in position but also in momentum. The conjecture is still open, but there are partial results. In 2006, together with Stefan Nonnenmacher, we proved that the measure mu must have positive entropy, still always assuming that M has negative curvature. And this is the entropy from ergodic theory, the entropy of an invariant measure of a dynamical system. It measures, very roughly speaking, the complexity of the orbits in the support of the measure mu. A much more recent result is due to Dyatlov-Jean in constant curvature and Dyatlov-Jean Nonnenmacher in variable curvature. It's for surfaces, only dimension 2. And it says that the measure mu, limit of eigenfunctions, must have positive measure on every open set. These two results are complementary. None of them is stronger than the other. It brings different information on the measure mu. But they both have as corollary that the measure mu cannot be a singular measure supported on a closed geodesic. Remember, I said just before that for a sphere, it's possible to have mu, a singular measure, on in negative curvature, it's not possible, and this is a corollary of the two theorems above. Two remarks. For each eigenfunction, we have the unique continuation property that an eigenfunction cannot vanish identically on an open set. So for every k, it's true that for an open set omega, the integral over omega of psi k of x squared is positive. But what we don't know a priori if this lower bound stays positive in the limit where lambda k goes to infinity. And this is what the result by Dyatlov-Jean says. The second remark is related to the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Suppose I have an eigenfunction of the Laplacian of eigenvalue lambda. If I am on Euclidean space, it means that its Fourier transform is supported, it's a distribution supported on a sphere of radius square root of lambda. If I am on a manifold, this statement doesn't really make sense, but I can restrict the eigenfunction to a coordinate chart, and I can take the Fourier transform in local coordinates. And what remains true is that the Fourier transform is supported in an annulus of radius going from 1 minus epsilon square root of lambda to 1 plus epsilon square root of lambda, modulo some small error. So the L2 norm of the Fourier transform outside the annulus is going to tend to zero when lambda goes to infinity. So I can write the Heisenberg principle, but it wouldn't really make sense to measure the mean square distance of the momentum to a fixed point since we know a priori that the support of the Fourier transform is moving to infinity when lambda grows to infinity. What we have to do first is to scale the Fourier transform by a factor 1 over square root of lambda, so that the support a priori is contained in an annulus of radius going from 1 minus epsilon to 1 plus epsilon. And epsilon is arbitrarily small. So let's call h, let's denote h the factor 1 over square root of lambda. It's also supposed to be reminiscent of the Planck constant in quantum mechanics. And let's define the rescaled Fourier transform f hat sub h of psi, which is f hat of psi over h, and I renormalize it to still have L2 norm equal to 1 if f has L2 norm equal to 1. So now the Heisenberg principle using this new rescaled Fourier transform reads as follows. If I have a function of L2 norm 1, the mean distance square of a point of x of the position x to a point A times the mean distance square of the momentum psi to a point B, but for the rescaled distribution, must be bounded below by some constant times h. Okay, this is the usual Heisenberg principle involving the Planck constant h. So if lambda goes to infinity here, h is going to zero. For fixed h, it's still true that there is some joint delocalization of position and momentum, but when h goes to zero, at the limit, nothing remains of the Heisenberg principle, which in physics is related to the fact that when h goes to zero, we go to quantum mechanics and there is no uncertainty principle in classical mechanics. When h goes to zero, quantum mechanics converges to classical mechanics. So what we did in our proof, so both in our proof and in the proof of Dyatlov-Jean, is to start with an uncertainty principle formulated at small scale, so at the scale of 1 over square root of lambda. In my work with Stefan Nonnenmacher, we used the entropic uncertainty principle in the version I gave earlier. In the work of Dyatlov and Jean, they used a new uncertainty principle called the fractal uncertainty principle, which says that it's not possible for a function and its Fourier transform to be both supported in a fractal set. And fractal means a set that has a lot of holes, a bit like in Shubin's result that I quoted, but also it must have some self-similarity. So we started with an uncertainty principle at small scale, but to make it a global statement of the whole manifold, we also needed to use the invariance of the measure mu under the geodesic flow. And a small remark for experts is that instead of working in the position and momentum coordinates, like I've done so far, we decompose the phase space into the stable and unstable directions of the geodesic flow. My talk is over. I would like to give some references. To prepare this talk, I used two very nice survey papers, one by Follon and Sitaram, and one by Donohoe and Stark. There are many other subjects that I would have liked to cover, but I couldn't for lack of time. But if you want to go further studying this topic, you might want to look for uncertainty principle on more general groups than the Euclidean space RD, or for more general representations of Lie groups than the Heisenberg representation, the Schrödinger representation of the Heisenberg group. For this, you will find a lot of information in the paper by Folland and Sitaram, and it's actually a subject that is very well developed in India. Recently, there also have been a lot of work on generalization of the Hardy principle in non-Euclidean geometries, such as hyperbolic geometry, graphs, etc. And you might also want to look for references on this subject. That's it for today, and thank you for your attention.